I'm going to go ahead and get started in the interest of getting everyone to the reception at the end of the day on time. My name is Emily Badger. I'm a writer at the Washington Post. And this last panel is, as you might have suspected, in response to the previous conversation. Thank you. So the previous panel talked about mobility. So we are, in response, your place-based panel. And I'm joined up here by Yusef Freeman, who is a vice president at McCormick Barron Salazar, which is a real estate developer that's actually doing the work on the ground in a lot of communities that have been traditionally disinvested, trying to actually figure out how to do the work of revitalizing them. Sitting next to him is Jared Bernstein, who's a senior fellow at the center. He's been there since 2011. Prior to that, he was the chief economist and economic advisor to Joe Biden and a member of the president's economic team. He's also a prolific writer for the Washington Post's Outlook section. In fact, writes more often than I do, I think. And then sitting next to me is Pedro Noguera, who's a professor of education at UCLA only very recently, after having spent the last dozen years or so at NYU, and is a really sort of thoughtful, well-known scholar, particularly on urban education, on thinking about things like you know, how schools are influenced by social and economic conditions, by demographics, the role of schools within communities. And so the conversation that I think that we want to have, particularly in light of the fact that we've just talked about mobility, is, you know, first off, to acknowledge that the place-based conversation is incredibly messy and complicated. And I think part of the reason why the media and the public really sort of jumped onto the mobility story in response to Raj's research is that, you know, it is a very sort of simple, satisfying story to think that we could take a low-income kid and move them from Baltimore City to Montgomery County and fundamentally change their prospects. It is much more complicated and less satisfying to get into the nitty-gritty of the question of, well, you know, how do we make Baltimore City more like Montgomery County in the ways that are successful there? You know, how do we start to sort of change those places? And for a whole variety of reasons, you know, I think that we have to be very sort of honest with ourselves about the fact that there is a lot that we don't know about the answer to these questions of, you know, what, how to revitalize places, how to do that without displacement, how to create mixed income communities without pushing people out. And, you know, I think that this is a harder conversation for us to have, in part because we don't have the data in many ways. You know, this stuff is incredibly difficult to research. You know, I don't, as a journalist, have an example that I can point to where I can say, you know, if you take a public housing project, you go in, you redevelop it, turn it into a mixed income project, invest in the school next to it, plant a community garden, make that also a job training site, and if you do all of those things, low-income kids who grow up there will earn 26% more by their late 20s than if you had never done all of those things. I mean, that's just, that's data that doesn't exist. I'm not suggesting that, you know, researchers should go out and create that data, because I think that's probably impossible to do, but the lack of data like that and kind of concrete numbers that we can point to sort of suggesting what works really, I think, kind of hampers this conversation. And I think, you know, it's further complicated by the fact that even if we do come up with a model that works, you know, just because it works in one location doesn't mean that it's going to work in another location. And the third thing that I often think about that makes this an incredibly messy conversation is that, you know, once we start talking about revitalizing communities, then we sort of inevitably wander into a conversation about gentrification and displacement. And, you know, no sooner have we started talking about investing in places than now we're talking about, well, what happens if people get pushed out of them? So, you know, this is a spoiler alert, I guess, that we're not going to give you, like, the magic formula, because I don't think that it exists. But, you know, that's not to say that there's not some good work going on out there about this. And I think, you know, Yusef is probably, you know, the best person to start us off on that topic, because, you know, you're actually going into communities, doing this in San Francisco, you've done this in New Orleans, done this work in a number of places. And I wonder if you can start by telling us a little bit about, you know, when you walk into a community that has historically been disinvested, how do you even begin to think about, like, what are the first, you know, 3, 5, 10 things we do? You know, how do you think about doing the actual work that converts a neighborhood into a place that has high opportunity so that we're not just talking about moving people into other communities?
Well, first, after you listed all of those things that we can do to help improve neighborhoods, I was hoping Roger was going to say, okay, we're going to get on that data, and that's the next set of analysis. But, you know, everyone in this room is very familiar with the history of urban America, from redlining that kept people of color from being able to move into and purchase in neighborhoods that would appreciate economically and value, to flight to the suburbs, and now we have the return to the cities, and a lot of our strong market neighborhoods are now facing displacement around the country, particularly on the coasts. And it's really in these neighborhoods where we've tried to target and get ahead of the market and work with these communities and the residents so that they can control their own destiny as their neighborhoods get revitalized, as they participate and are able to participate as much as they want to in the revitalization of their neighborhoods as we work together to create communities of choice. One example where we had some success was in New Orleans after Katrina, where we went into an area. It was a former public housing site. It was called the Magnolia and then CJ Pete. There were about 120 plus households, families living there at the time of the storm. And we worked with them to redevelop the neighborhood into a fully economically integrated mixed-income community of about 460 units, where, you know, we replaced all of the occupied public housing units as well as doing additional public housing units. I think there's about 193. We did an additional 140 plus affordable units and about 120 plus market rate units. And these 460 units were developed in about 115 buildings, and every building had market rate units in it, had public housing replacement units in it, and had affordable units in it. So we weren't doing any type of income segregation on the site. We were looking for that full integration. And that investment really served as a catalyst for other things to happen in the neighborhood. But we recognized very early on that bricks and sticks alone aren't going to transform the lives of the folks who are moving into this new community. And so whenever we work in a public housing community, we work with a national nonprofit called Urban Strategies that provides community supportive services for the residents who need them. And so in the case of New Orleans, first and foremost, that meant where are these residents dispersed to after the storm? So doing things to find residents who are all over the country. But then providing, first letting them know that they have a right to return, that they have the priority into moving into any of these new units, and providing job training where needed, providing education programs, GED programs. In some cases, we were doing record expungements for ex-offenders, but really all of the items that were necessary to make sure that these residents who were returning could be successful in this new mixed income housing. So going beyond then working with the residents, you know, needing to make sure that there was a high quality place for them to go to school when they returned. And, you know, our chairman, Richard Barron, always harps, and he says, you know what, whenever a suburban developer goes into a new track, they're required to build a new school. Why isn't that the same for urban areas? And there's all kinds of reasons for that. But you know, we made a commitment to the Recovery School District in New Orleans, and we offered $20 million of our New Markets Tax Credits allocation to help rebuild the neighborhood school to make sure that the school was moved up in priority so that when the housing was completed, there was a high-quality school for them to attend. Unfortunately, at that time, there wasn't the infrastructure in place at the Recovery School District to use those credits, but they did move up the school so that it was available when the residents were complete. And we were able to, in the future, you know, so many schools in New Orleans who needed the resources, we were able to work out and put our new markets toward that. So now that we have rooftops, now that we've worked to stabilize families, now that we have an education system, you know, what else are needed for a neighborhood to be comprehensive? So we partnered with a local nonprofit organization that developed both for sale at the market rate and affordable throughout the neighborhood to make sure that we're making those investments in the neighborhood, as well as partnered with a local retail developer to bring in high quality retail that really lacked in the neighborhood. And now we've created this comprehensive neighborhood that has long-term affordability preserved, has changed the market. And so as folks follow us in who want to go and do the luxury housing, we have a place where folks aren't going to get displaced and having that true economic integration. And obviously, you know, the resources to be able to do such a development are few and far between. And it took, you know, the investments from the private sector, from traditional banks doing debt and equity, to the state putting in funds, the local housing authority. We had a Hope 6 grant at the time. And so stacking all of these different sources. And now HUD has the Choice Neighborhoods Program, and I think our leader of the D.C. Housing Authority may have been referring to that program, where they provide up to $30 million grants to focus on housing investments, neighborhood investments, education, and people investments. And, you know, we're lucky if five of those grants are awarded each year, and we know that there's thousands of neighborhoods around the country that could use that investment. But something that HUD has done, they've provided these planning grants, which in a lot of communities that will never be competitive for an implementation grant, it serves as a catalyst to bring voices together that haven't really coordinated before. So you have your school districts working with your cities, working with communities, working with education and health systems to come up with a plan that can be owned by the neighborhood, can be owned by the residents, and implemented by them to make sure that there's a place for everyone once the neighborhood goes through its revitalization.
Did everyone who temporarily left that neighborhood because of Katrina, did they have a chance to come back?
Absolutely, they had priorities, but as you know, the previous couple of panels, you know, we spoke with residents who were placed in places of high opportunity and all of a sudden had jobs, better schools, and didn't have an interest in necessarily coming back. But, you know, we made sure to have more units available on the public housing side so that those who wanted to come back could come back to this particular development. And actually, the first resident to move back into any revitalized public housing site in New Orleans was a public housing resident at the time of the storm who went through the Community Supportive Services Program and moved into a market rate unit. Now, that is by no way, shape, or form the common outcome that we have when we go through this program, but it was something that was very anecdotally interesting to see.
When we had a conversation about all of this beforehand, Pedro, you made a comment that you can only think of two cities in America that are making a concerted effort at revitalizing a distressed neighborhood in a way that is not producing displacement. And I think New Orleans was not one of the ones that you were thinking of, but can you tell us what those two examples are and why you can only think of two of them?
And I have to, I mean, respectfully, Yusef, the insurance companies deliberately delayed paying on the policies of many of the families in New Orleans, which prevented many from coming back.
Sure, I was only speaking to these particular public housing residents.
Okay,
I definitely wasn't speaking to the entire city of New Orleans.
I'm getting over here heated up because
absolutely.
Because what's happened in New Orleans is a travesty to the black community in that city, and I don't think it was just market forces that did it. I think there was a deliberate effort to remove large numbers of low-income black people permanently from the city. You know, as I think about, and this is a good study, where are we seeing communities that where poor people are not being displaced, where the quality of life is improving, and what's happening there, right? And as I said, I can't think of too many. Now, Ingrid, who is here, might know of more than I do, but I can think of two. the Dudley neighborhood in Boston, which has been engaged in over 20 years now of a community-led revitalization that's focused on housing, but it's also focused on retail, on many of the things that Yusef just talked about. They're now focusing on schools, and I think what's particularly important about it is it was neighborhood-led with support from city officials, private sector, foundations, et cetera. The other one that's impressive is Tulsa. And Tulsa is interesting because of its history. Many of you know that Tulsa had a race riot in 1924 where the black community was destroyed. And the Greenwood section that was destroyed is now the site where a lot of revitalization is occurring. But what's interesting about it is they're not just focusing on housing, which they are, but they're also focusing on neighborhood institutions, like museums. They're focusing on schools. Every school in Tulsa is a community school with preschool. And Tulsa's had universal preschool before any other city in the country. After school programs, health clinics on site. The major public high school in Tulsa is integrated, 50% black, and it's the top high school in the city. Now, I cite that because when were we making greatest progress in reducing disparities in academic achievement? Well, it was in the 1970s when we were committed to integration. And not only when we committed to integration, but we were committed to anti-poverty efforts outside of school, right? And I would say that in the places where those kinds of commitments are still occurring, we are seeing some change. Now, the sad thing is that we can't point to enough of those examples because it does take policy that looks more comprehensively at housing, at education, at health, at jobs, because people need all those to have a viable community. But I think that that's was the promise of the promised neighborhoods that didn't really come to fruition, although there are pockets. I've been to Durham, I've been to Fort Worth, where people are still working on the idea, but without the level of public investment that they needed. I think if you consider it, with the debate or the discussion we've been having today is, do we move poor people out to opportunity, or is there any chance of revitalizing the places where they are? Think about this. We blew a major opportunity in Detroit. We had this massive federal investment to save the auto industry. What did Detroit get out of it? What did the people of Detroit get out of it? Very little. Detroit is being remade right now, not for the people of Detroit. It's being called the New Brooklyn. It's gentrifying rapidly. Whole Foods is downtown. It's going to be a different city with very different demographics. And so I think that there are opportunities that we have lost. New Orleans was another one where we could have created a more integrated, stable community. Education's got to play a role in that, but not the way we are focused on reform right now. It's ironic. If you look at a lot of our cities, that's why Tulsa stands out, because here you have an urban high school that's integrated and attracts white people, right? They call it, the white people in Tulsa call it Booker Free, because you can get a free private school education there, right? In New York City, and which has been the epicenter of reform, there's been no investment in the schools in poor neighborhoods, except for charter schools. But even the charter schools do not offer what we once offered. You go to a school like DeWitt Clinton High School, which once had 6,000 kids, which this proud alumni, which offered lab science and a whole array of electives. You go there now, it's a total shadow of itself. It's 2,000 kids, a third of them are homeless, a largest number of kids who have been released from incarceration. It could never attract middle class people, right? In fact, anybody who can tries to avoid that school. And so I would say public disinvestment in these communities, particularly in the schools, is driving gentrification, and it's driving the ongoing deterioration of public education.
Why? So what are some of the biggest obstacles that prevent there from being more examples like in Boston, like in Tulsa? Is it the structure of federal programs that might enable this work? Is it, a sort of sense among the community that this is too hard, it's futile, look at Sandtown, Winchester, and Baltimore, and all that money they threw at it, and it didn't do anything for them. What is the thing that stands between us and having more examples like that?
I would have to say it's ideology. But what's interesting about that is Tulsa. Because Tulsa is a very red city. It's run by Republicans. And it's Republicans who have driven the preschool. It's the Republicans. The mayor's wife leads the effort to create the community schools. So it doesn't cut your typical ways in terms of the ideological split. But I would say in most of our big cities, the vision of reform is that charter schools is what's going to fix our schools. You look at D.C., another example. But what's the investment in Southeast D.C.? You know, you go to a school like Bellew High School. It's, who would be, you couldn't attract a middle, you can't attract anybody there, right? And I would say there's no vision driving what they're doing in education or even for that neighborhood. So they're setting it up to be gentrified. They're setting it up for those people to be displaced and pushed to Prince George's and elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. So, Jared, I want to pull you into this for a minute. Let's say we go into a neighborhood and we create mixed-income housing, we invest in schools, we build that community garden I was talking about earlier. How much is all of that going to help if we are not solving the employment problem that exists in these communities as well?
Well, I am struck by how little discussion we've had today about jobs. And it seems like a really important omission. I'm not casting any aspersions because people have enough to talk about with all the nuances. But let me introduce my comments with, first of all, by saying I work at the Center on Budget, and I know how challenging it is to put on a great event like this. So congratulations to Barbara. And when this is done, you can go get drunk. So I'm very impressed. I've put on a couple of these, and they weren't anywhere as good as this one. So I feel a little embarrassed. Two caveats about this question. One is that I am not burdened by the knowledge that the other people on the stage have on the nuances of what we've been talking about today. And two, I'm a little bit one of these people, I'm afraid, who when if your only tool is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And so I think a ton about labor demand. Partly it's a kind of a Keynesian orientation, but I work in all the same areas that everyone else has talked about today, and where we plumb the depths of poverty at the Center on Budget. But my orientation is very much from the perspective of labor demand, of job growth. Maybe part of that it comes from working for the administration in the heart of the deepest downturn since the Great Depression, when I literally had to go outside in front of TV cameras and explain to the nation that we just lost 700,000 jobs last month. I remember preparing for one of those with David Axelrod, and he was pushing me out there saying, "Go ahead, Bernstein, anyone can sell good news." So I have this very, very, and I've recognized that over the past 30, 35 years, we've actually been at full employment in this economy only 30% of the time. I mean, that is a national macroeconomic, if not disaster, then very slow-burning, deep problem. And this problem is particularly amplified in the kinds of neighborhoods we're talking about, and for particularly African Americans. And by the way, I noticed Valerie Wilson is here today. She wrote a paper on the benefits of full employment for African Americans, and it's kind of a almost a statistical dive into this notion that when the economy sniffles, people of color catch pneumonia, and vice versa. It's not a coincidence that the black unemployment rate is twice that of the white unemployment rate in good times and bad times. So I think that it will be very hard to solve the kinds of problems we're setting out to solve unless we tackle this part of the problem, which is also fundamental. And I suspect that that's you know, yet another big thing to put on a list of all the different problems we have to solve, if you listen to the last session, for example. But in fact, I'd put it very much at the top. And in double fact, I think it might solve some of the other problems. I don't think that I've written pretty extensively about the benefits of, say, two-parent families for child outcomes. I know that work. My dissertation advisor, these many decades ago, is Irv Garfinkel, who's married to Sarah McClanahan, so it's kind of in my genetics a little bit. But if a poor person marries another poor person and there aren't any jobs, it's not going to help. I'm certainly very sympathetic to the importance of upskilling and the kinds of educational issues that we've talked about. And I want to be very clear that because I'm emphasizing employment doesn't mean that I discount any of these other things. It's just that in the absence of employment, and I mean robust employment opportunities with that either pay living wages or combined with work supports provide living wages, robust subsidies like the earned income tax credit, it will be extremely hard to achieve the goals we're setting out today. And as I mentioned a second ago, I believe there's at least circumstantial evidence that when labor market opportunities improve for African American men, they become more attractive marriage partners in ways that can help solve that side of the problem as well. So that kind of gets then to your question, Emily, which is, so what do we do? And here there have been a number of I almost call them pilots projects. New Hope is one. We've talked about Moving to Opportunity. There's been a number of pilot projects that I think come down to the following, and you're welcome to accuse me of confirmation bias, of sort of seeing what I want to see in these studies. There are probably people in this audience who know them better than I do. Maybe some of you even completed them, you know, were responsible for evaluating them. But I take from these studies that a true job saturation idea, where you really have a surplus of employment opportunities that are lasting, hasn't been tried. And when, as a New Hope, when in fact there was a direct job creation component to the program, it worked well. And there were some pretty good long-term outcomes for the kids of parents who were in those programs, according to what are they called? Run DMC? What's the MDRC? Sorry. So I think we have to do more to pursue a full employment agenda of the type that I constantly go on about. My most recent book was called The Reconnection Agenda, which you can get for free on the internet, which is all about this. But even at full employment, we're not going to reach some of the folks we're talking about here, especially people with incarceration records. So we do have to think about direct job creation in a much more saturated and lasting way.
Let's fantasize for a minute in a concrete way about, let's say you're going into Southeast Washington and you're trying to create dozens or even hundreds of jobs. I mean, are we talking about bringing in an employer and having public subsidies support the hiring of people there?
Yeah, I think that's probably what we're talking about. I mean, I'd at least try two things. First, I would try something that has lots of complementary benefits, which is a deep dive into repairing our national public infrastructure, which I believe would have employment spillovers to precisely the kinds of folks you're talking about. People talk a lot about roads and bridges and water systems, and all for that, but I actually like the idea of a program called FAST, Fix America Schools Today, an infrastructure program that is dedicated to improving the stock of the almost 90,000 public schools across this nation, which need work, even in Alexandria, where I live, a rich community. So I like that idea, and certainly in the neighborhoods you're talking about. But because I don't think you're going to reach some of the most disadvantaged people with that kind of a program, I would think about something like something built off of the TANF Emergency Fund job creation program that we implemented during the during the Great Recession as part of the Recovery Act. Various people, some of whom are in this room, Donna Pavetti, have written extensively about this. I thought it was a very effective, strong bang for the buck direct employment program where private employers, for the most part, hired folks where wages were subsidized up to 80-90% of the wage, time limited. So again, it had a big bang for the buck when we looked at what it cost to create employment.
I like that you already came up with an acronym for your program.
Well, not only that, it's a bill. It's an existing bill that, in this Congress, it's probably died. But in the last Congress, it was a bill introduced by Sherrod Brown and Rosa DeLauro.
Pedro, you want to add to that?
Yeah, I think there are a few small but promising efforts that we should look at. I'm on the board of a group called Year Up. I'm not sure how many people know Year Up. But Year Up is all private sector. It's working with 18 to 25-year-olds with only either a GED or a high school diploma. 6 months of training, it's getting them to jobs making $40,000, $50,000 a year in high tech and finance. It's a partnership with the key sectors that have job growth. And they're looking at the training to match the job needs. I think we have a lot of potential with career and technical high schools that have not been tapped. So I think education is going to be a key part of this too. And I do think infrastructure is an opportunity, but we have to also look at other sectors.
Yusef, you mentioned earlier expunging criminal records as something that was happening as part of the project in New Orleans, and that jumped out at me as being quite interesting because that is not something that normally real estate developers are thinking about. Do you guys think about this employment piece? Do you think about, that's defining your role quite expansively.
Sure, and the record expungement, and while we definitely have a reputation for being, good developers, if you will. I mean, for us, it's really about the success of the residents within the new mixed income housing, which will give them other benefits in their life as they grow. But for us, it comes down to how can we make it easy for residents to pay rent, right? How can we protect our own bottom line? We were very concerned with issues of displacement, and so when folks were displaced after Katrina, we actually had radio ads in Atlanta, Houston, St. Louis, all the heaviest places where folks were displaced. We even used skip tracing, the same information and systems that bill collectors use to find people to let them know that they have an opportunity to come back. And when it comes to jobs, of course, they had first source opportunity for the construction jobs to rebuild the new community. But also when the retail was built, we developed a partnership with the retailers there for them to train our residents, and we received some philanthropic dollars. In fact, I saw someone here from the Kellogg Foundation. They provided some philanthropic dollars for that training. And so the public housing residents had also first source opportunity for the retail, so you could walk to work and not deal with any kind of commuting or transit issues.
So I want to talk a little bit about, there's sort of a fundamental tension at the heart of any conversation that we have about revitalizing a neighborhood, which is that, ideally in the abstract, we want to move towards having more mixed income communities, which means in a community that's been historically disinvested and, had a high poverty rate, we're talking, not just about sort of lifting up the income levels of the people who live there and their quality of life, but also upper income people moving in. But as soon as we start talking about that, then I think there's a lot of concern about, is that sustainable, or are we just sort of tipping the scales to a community that then increasingly becomes upper income and all of those people get pushed out? How do we reconcile those goals of, wanting to create mixed income places, but also recognizing that the moment those people start moving in is when a lot of people get concerned?
Well, I think that's where we have to look at ways to stabilize and secure the housing in those rapidly gentrifying areas. There are, especially in New York, DC, the Bay Area, Denver, there are rapidly gentrifying, this goes in contrast to what Cheryl said earlier. wealthy whites are moving into poor Black and Latino neighborhoods. If we can stabilize the housing for the people who are already there and then create good schools where they'd be willing to put their kids in, you could actually start to create much healthier neighborhoods. We have an example of a place like this, Stapleton in Denver. Stapleton is the old airport that was deliberately planned to be a mixed-income area. It's now a stable neighborhood with good schools. It's racially and socioeconomically diverse. Now, they have the benefit of starting from scratch, but it does show that with the right planning, we can, in fact, create healthy neighborhoods that work for people.
Yusef, did you want to add to that?
Yeah, and we're really doing this all over the country, and there's examples of it, east, west, southeast, south. You know, the challenge is, and even with our different reactions to what took place in New Orleans, the challenges in the toughest cities in this country are so high that even if you're able to transform one neighborhood in New Orleans, there are so many others that didn't get that type of investment or didn't have the same type of community organization at the foundation of it to get the outcomes that you may see in another neighborhood, even if you had the same amount of dollar investment in that other community. And so it's really difficult to make the needle move from a city perspective, from a regional perspective, when each neighborhood needs that type of coordination and investment.
Mm-hmm. Let's dwell on schools for a minute, since we have you here, Pedro. I mean, even if we have a community that becomes mixed income over time, you know, for instance, Capitol Hill in Washington, this is one of these places that a lot of upper income people are moving into, and in fact, you can have schools that from the outside look like they are economically and racially diverse, but it is still possible to walk into the school and you have tracking going on, you know, kids are not in the same classes with each other. There's still a complicated problem there that's about more than just getting new people to send their kids to public schools.
Right, so that's why you need the educational plan to go with it, to ensure that the learning opportunities that would accompany an integrated schools are accessible to the low-income families of color. Again, there are small numbers of cases like this. They're not that many. The truth is that what you describe is what you see more typically around the country. However, there are some examples of schools that have figured out how to serve both populations well and maintain them. It's not easy because as soon as a school is successful, then the demand coming from the affluent parents grows, and then there's a pressure to push out the low-income families. So this is where policy becomes important. This is the reason why I know Phil was here earlier. I'm skeptical of allowing charters to be the entity that does this because there's not a policy regulation on charters to maintain a kind of balance in these schools. But I do think charters could play a role if we had policies ensuring equity and access and deliberately ensuring that the hard to serve, the most disadvantaged families also were served in those schools.
Jared, you raised an issue with me prior to the panel that Cheryl Cashin touched on this very briefly earlier, that, you know, kind of simultaneous to everything that we're talking about, income segregation is on the rise and inequality is on the rise. And increasingly, you know, we're seeing people sort of spatially sorting so that the resources and the schools and the communities that the wealthy are going to are completely different from the resources and schools and the communities that low-income people are going into. Does that whole set of forces make everything that we're talking about even harder, make it worse? How do you think about that in this context?
I think it unquestionably makes it harder, and I think that to the extent that you can draw causality from a lot of correlations, which is not nearly the extent that we, A, would like it to, and B, that we sometimes make it sound when we talk about it, I do think that this problem of residential segregation by income is likely causally linked to the broader inequalities within the economy, whether it's inequalities of income or wages or wealth, or for that matter, political power, which especially in our heavily moneyed politics are very closely linked. And so Ben Spielberg, who I work with at the center, and I wrote a piece in The Atlantic magazine where we tried to explore the impact of inequality on the issue of mobility, which again pops right out of Raj's work as well. And we thought that there were three channels by which it was having a negative, by which our high levels of inequality were having negative effects on the mobility of kids that has been at the core of some of what we've talked about today. That would be residential segregation by income is one, and you need no look no further than what's the guy from I think Stanford who writes about this. Sean Reardon's work is, I think, very persuasive on this point. And secondly, through the education channel, which we were just talking to, because lack of once you're a family that's bedeviled by residential segregation, you're facing an inequality of educational access, which has lifelong consequences. And thirdly, and this is one that we've really talked a lot about at the center, and I think in some ways it's the most important and in some ways the least appreciated, which is the direct impact of high levels of inequality on the low levels of income of people at the bottom of the scale. We often talk about inequality in relative terms, but if you look at sort of this, I think it's a kind of a famous graph now that looks at productivity growth going up and median compensation just staying flat, that inequality wedge between growth and actual, you know, real compensation. So now we're not talking relative, we're talking about, it was what Sheldon Danziger said earlier, you know, years of stagnant earnings. That in itself is a significant problem. And interestingly, importantly, a lot of the safety net programs that many of us grew up thinking of as consumption-oriented, you know, give somebody some food stamps or now SNAP, and, you know, they eat for a day or a week or a month, are turning out to work more like investments that offset some of this a function of inequality and its long-lasting negative impacts on people's, on kids' outcomes. Simply more income through, say, an EITC for a poor child relative to one who doesn't have that income in later life leads to higher levels of earnings and higher levels of employment. We've been able to, researchers have been able to look at the initial dispersion of food stamps, which didn't go everywhere at once, and you can see that as George Bush said, this ain't exactly rocket surgery. A family has better nutrition relative to a kid who's in those same economic circumstances but didn't get nutritional support. Well, the outcomes are better in terms of employment, earnings, education, I think more for women than for men in that case, and so on. There's a whole school of medical thought now having to do with toxic stress, actual physical detriments that people carry around with them because of the stress and strains of poverty, and I'm sure it's exacerbated in these concentrated spaces. So those are all ways in which inequality makes this worse.
Yusef, I asked you earlier about sort of, you know, when you walk into a community that suffers from all of these problems, you know, how do you begin to think about attacking that? But as a sort of follow-up to that, how do you think about, in the abstract, what that community will hopefully look like in the future? I mean, I'm thinking about this in part because for some reason Whole Foods kept coming up at our table over lunch. Like, does that community have a Whole Foods in it? You know, does that community have a lot of buildings like the kind that you described, where, you know, the income integration is not just in the neighborhood but it's at the building level? What does it look like? What do I see when I walk down the sidewalk in that place?
So, the whole economic integration by building has been a core philosophy of our company now for 40 years, and I completely drank the Kool-Aid on it. And it, you know, getting out to California in the Bay Area, where the demand for just affordable housing is so high, and looking at that, you know, it creates some other questions and kind of gets us thinking about other alternatives. But in the examples that I gave, we're really about serving as that catalyst to turn a neighborhood around. And we want to do that with a big splash, with scale, with housing of enough scale where we are taking a place that had suffered under decades of disinvestment and making it a community of choice, and doing it in a way where we're preserving long-term affordability as well. You know, at some point, the market is going to take over, and so you are going to see those benefits. And as long as the housing is stabilized and the residents are receiving the services that are critical to make sure they're successful, the schools are in place, then the hope is that they will benefit from all these other market forces going on as well and won't be required to leave because we have that long-term affordability. One of the other challenges, though, and particularly in a place like the Bay Area, is it's great, okay, we have, you know, affordable housing and in San Francisco and most of the redevelopment areas, they're going to want to cap that at 50% of the area median income. So what's that next tier? If everything is going right and you're getting the support you need and you're getting the jobs and the education, what's that next tier of housing when you are making too much to live in that housing? Because all of a sudden you're not going to be able to buy, you know, a home in San Francisco. And so making sure there's that next tier of rental housing that we call, you know, unrestricted housing, which may, you know, be market rate or just below market rate, but is not restricted due to any covenants. And we've had some flexibility in other communities where a public housing resident will become a market rate housing resident, but can't necessarily afford the market rate. So particularly for households that are returning families, we're able to give some rent opportunities at the below market rate. So it's getting creative. Sometimes we are more social workers than developers, but really wanting folks from the community to be successful.
I started off the conversation at the very beginning suggesting that there is a lot that we don't know about what works and data that we don't have, especially relative to thinking about what does work in the mobility space. So I wonder if each of you can address, you know, something that you acknowledge. I mean, we don't have the answer for this. You know, there's data that I would love to have about, you know, the outcomes of children who grew up in that community, or, you know, just lay out there for me something that you don't know that we don't have the answer for in this conversation.
We don't have an answer for a lot. I mean, if you think about it, there are these isolated, depressed communities. I'm thinking Buffalo, North Chicago, places where there's the only message to send is leave, you know? And it's, at least right now, maybe Buffalo may not be as bad as some of these other places that I can think of, but the prospects of reviving the economy are so dim. West Virginia, at least pockets, that's a huge problem because not everybody can leave. And I don't see how, as a nation, we begin to really address this problem of intergenerational poverty unless we come up with economic strategies that allow us to address the needs where they are, because not everybody can leave.
I would really echo that. I mean, I think we maybe know a little bit more than we think we do, and that what I think we know, what I walk around thinking I know, is that poverty, whether it's in a concentrated area or whether it's in a rural area, when I hear concentrated poverty, I think the solution to that is is a poverty solution as much as a concentrated poverty solution. And those solutions involve the kind of things I've tried to talk about today. So I feel like I know, based on those three channels I just articulated through the inequality chain, residential segregation by income, the education channel, and the direct impacts of having low income, I know that all of those generate the negative outcomes that we're trying to stop. So the thing I don't know, the question I have, is why the hell don't we do more to address those? And that's a political question.
Mm-hmm. Yusef, what doesn't MBS know how to do?
Well, the real challenge is we do these transformative developments, and I really wonder about the impact that it has on the parents and the grandparents that are moving into the new housing, and the physician from Boston referred to housing as a vaccine, and I'm going to use that everywhere I go now, because the stability of the housing is definitely a benefit. But in terms of income outcomes, safety, health, all of those things, and seeing Raj's presentation kind of gave me hope that even if we don't see those outcomes for those initial households that move in, it's their children and their grandchildren that are going to benefit from those outcomes. And, you know, we just don't have that data yet. And so that's something we would love to know.
While I ask one more question, if folks want to start queuing up at the microphone, we'd love to bring more people in. But this is a question about whether or not anyone up here is hearing anything about any of the topics that we have been talking about in the presidential election. I mean, I feel like we were having this amazing year where everyone was talking about these topics, you know, because of Ferguson, because of Baltimore, because of the Supreme Court decision, because of AFFH, and all of this momentum sort of like smacked into a presidential campaign where we're not having this conversation there. We've been having this conversation a lot of other unusual places for the last year, but maybe you all are hearing something I'm not.
I'm not hearing anything you're not, but then again, you and I probably run in a pretty similar circle. It is the case that Secretary Clinton, and you wrote a piece about this, was talking about this or went to a CAP, presented at a Center for American Progress discussion about these very issues, and is aware of such things. And I've heard Governor Bush, Jeb Bush, talk about these issues. I believe that Ms. Clinton is interested in a housing voucher solution, and I believe that Governor Bush is interested in neighborhoods in some broad way. Beyond that, no, we haven't. By the way, I should say, and this is important and germane, if you're thinking about job creation, you know, there we have, because that's key, that to me is at the heart of this, Bernie Sanders does have a very aggressive job creation agenda, which, you know, requires some resources that might not be, you know, obviously forthcoming from this sort of a Congress, but that's a different problem. But he certainly understands the lack of full employment.
Yeah, I would say the most hopeful conversations I hear, not in the amongst the presidential candidates in either party, but really in local communities. I get to travel quite a bit. Tacoma, just a week ago, they're doing some really innovative things in Tacoma that does link job creation to mental health, to addressing incarcerated, the incarcerated and getting them back into the workforce. I'm seeing leadership at the local level that gives me reason for hopefulness. I don't see that reflected at the federal level. At least I haven't heard it.
I'm letting Yusef take a pass on this question.
Just a quick point, though, if I may follow on. Just a very quick point was, I think that's very important, what Pedro was just saying. And when I wrote my book, it was such a depressing got to this part. It was really pretty depressing. So I devoted a chapter to precisely this idea. And there is, at the subnational level, you can find some stuff, and that's important.
Do we have some questions? Yeah, please.
I have a. My name is Judith Lieben. I'm an attorney at the Massachusetts Law Reform Institute. I live in a place called Somerville, Massachusetts, where no one can now afford to live, and I work in Boston, where no one can That's an overstatement. One thing that I think wasn't talked about, for those communities that are feeling gentrification pressure, and it's certainly not every place, or neighborhoods within cities that are feeling that, there have been developed over time a sort of a laundry list of things to try to make that gentrification more equitable. And I just think that it's important to remember what those things are. So I tried to remember. And some of them are, indeed, rent control, just cause eviction policies, disincentive to investors, especially investors who flip quickly, a high tax on flipping, tax breaks for long-time residents so that on their property tax, and homeowners, and indeed trying to develop more subsidized housing and preserving the subsidized housing that's there so there's a chance that even as some people leave, more people of similar income can come in. And those things are being tried in different places, but it takes political will, and it might not even take that much money, but it takes political will. Thanks.
You know, one thing that I would just add to that is that when we're talking about gentrifying communities, oftentimes we're focused on the housing piece and how do we keep people in their homes, and what we're not thinking about is, you know, well, what about businesses that are going to get displaced as well? You know, what happens if you're the low-income person who manages to stay in the changing neighborhood, but now there's not a laundromat in your neighborhood? Or, you know, now the place where you could afford to buy your groceries doesn't exist in the neighborhood. So I think, you know, in addition to some of those things that Judith just mentioned, policies that think as well about sort of other resources in the business community and how to keep them there, I think are really important too. Yeah.
Thank you. Interesting day, interesting panel. I'm Marcia Rosen from National Housing Law Project, but I was formerly a local official in San Francisco, redevelopment agency and the housing department. And what you read about San Francisco in the press, of course, is that we now have outdone New York in affordability on the private sector. There's no such thing as market rate in the common understanding that market rate is for ordinary people. Market rate is only luxury housing in San Francisco and has been for over 20 years. At the same time, on this past election last week, we voted in a $310 million affordable housing bond. In 96, we had $100 million. And this passed, it needed a two-thirds vote, and it passed in the high 70s. We also, to your last point, we just also adopted what they're calling legacy business fund. Not clear exactly how it's going to work, but for small businesses that have been in business for 30 years or more, they're going to be able to apply for subsidy funding to keep operating and serving those communities so that you still can maybe have a few shoemakers and other shops other than high-end restaurants and bars and coffee shops. And despite the displacement of lots of low-income and middle-income people who were from non-subsidized housing, even though we have a rent control and just cause eviction jurisdiction, we are investing more in our in preservation and development of 100% affordable. We are doing HUD's new RAD program is getting $80 million of local funds. And requiring that it's not just most of the portfolio, other than McCormick Barron and one other private development, is going to nonprofit mission-driven developers. The entire portfolio is transforming, and we're requiring service provision and have spent a lot of time and money on planning service provision and very strong tenant protections equivalent or greater than public housing protections, even though it's going to be project-based vouchers. So we did mention earlier that local communities can do something, and obviously it doesn't compete with what market forces are doing to the rest of San Francisco housing. But you can make a political and financial commitment locally. And more wealthy, I think this is an issue obviously for wealthier cities, but even wealthy cities are not making these investments proportionate to their ability in any way, shape, or form, or states. So I just want to see some bits of optimism. The city of Richmond, which is a poor city, just passed a just cause eviction last week, where rent control hasn't grown in the number of jurisdictions that have it, have not grown at all. So there are these little incidents of improvements and optimism for people at the bottom, and we should be promoting them more and encouraging them within networks of, you know, I'd like to see the U.S. Conference of Mayors talk about this rather than just decry the shrinkage of the home budget or the
CPG. If I can jump in, I think that's really a great point, and there is a germ of optimism in there that we need. I guess one quick reflection, and you kind of got at this in some of the comments towards the end of your point there, is that when I think about why San Francisco can do this or why New York City could do this if they wanted to, I think some of it has to do with the wealth generation that goes on in that city relative to, say, a Baltimore. Yeah. And it reminds me, just from putting on my hat as a macroeconomist, that a real constraint here is outside of the San Franciscos, where the IT has generated so much profitability, we are constrained by a national growth rate that's actually pretty low.
Yes.
I mean, we're doing much better than some of the basket cases in other places. You know, Europe's made lots of mistakes in some part, but you know, our productivity growth is actually frighteningly low. Our GDP growth is a point and a half lower than it used to be, and the experts tell us that that's where it's going to stay. We've lost labor force participation. A lot of this is residual damage of the Great Recession, right. Exacerbated by bad fiscal policy.
Right.
So I think a lot of people in this business think very much in micro terms, but there are connections to the macro that your question get to that I think are critical.
Yes, and I think, again, there are things that local communities, I just saw that in the metro that DC is having an employer-supported transit benefit, which we've talked about transportation, housing, and childcare being the three critical issues for family stability, being able to afford those things. And it's local, Jared, maybe you know more about this, that why is it only local communities that are talking about $15 an hour wage? And how do we spread that? So
that's another topic, but I do know a lot about that, and I'd be happy to talk with you later.
Thank you.
I actually want to come back to one point that Marcia made about this legacy business fund that was on the ballot in San Francisco, which it caught my eye when that happened because it's a really kind of unusual idea. Basically, what it says is that, you know, if you're a business that's been operating in San Francisco for 30 years or more, and if you provide some, you know, kind of benefit to the history and the culture of the neighborhood where you're based, you can apply to be a, quote, legacy business. And if you're granted this status, what would ideally happen is that, you know, you would be given some public subsidies to help cover your rent, but also the city wants...
Landlord would be given the subsidy.
Yes, the city wants to also incentivize landlords to give you a 10-year lease, I believe. It's basically designed to, you know, keep these businesses that might be displaced in the community longer, but it was immediately apparent to me that, you know, there are some difficult questions about, you know, if part of the criteria here has to do with, like, who contributes to the culture and history of a community, who's deciding which businesses get to be on these lists? And, you know, is this really a good idea? Is in some ways the people who control these lists, are they going to be picking economic winners and losers in these neighborhoods? I think the San Francisco Chronicle came out against this and was urging people not to vote on it, but it did pass, and actually...
No surprise there, but, you know...
Yeah, but Jared, I wonder as an economist whether this sounds like a good idea to you.
I think so. I don't get so spooked by this picking winners and losers thing. I think that they're... I'd like to learn more about it, and there definitely is a chance... There definitely are... is potential corruption and those sorts of things. But I think if it's done smartly, I remember when I worked for the White House, we were talking a lot about helping our manufacturers, which There are a lot of really great economic reasons why you should do that. And, you know, somebody would inevitably say, oh, the government's picking winners and losers. Well, we're way past, you know, we're more than a little pregnant on that already. If you look at the tax code, we're constantly picking winners and losers. So why don't we do it with some economic insight?
Anyway, that was done because California outlawed commercial rent control, which Berkeley tried to enact years ago and San Francisco thought about. So, I mean, a lot of these things are workarounds against policies that...
Yeah. Is there a question at the microphone in the back?
Yeah, I was just curious. So going back to this, Jared, your point that without sort of... or we haven't tested a full employment strategy and that without jobs, all the interventions and places won't achieve a fundamental difference in mobility. And I wonder, I actually think your focus admittedly is on labor demand, and I wonder if you could talk a little bit about labor supply and how that functions in this scenario, because even with job growth, if you're stuck in an isolated community, you don't have access to the kind of education that's gonna give you the skills to, especially in, you know, the changing work nature of the workforce, to access new jobs, or if you have a criminal record because you live in a community that's subject to excessive policing. So it seems like the job, there's two parts to the job equation. You talked about demand as being essential, and I wonder if you could talk a little bit about supply.
Yeah, no, that, I agree with what was implicit in every single thing you just said, and you said it very well. Especially in the more disadvantaged places we're thinking of here today, a demand-side-only strategy probably wouldn't work. It will work for more people than you think. Back in 1998, I think, so that this was before 9/11, which is important in this story, you'll see in a second. I was in a tram in a Chicago airport going from one terminal to another, and these two guys who worked for the airport, they had a lot of airport identification things on their dangling around their necks, were trying to figure out how they knew each other. They recognized each other. They both worked at the airport in different places, and I was eavesdropping, and they realized they'd met in prison. And to me, that was like, we must be at full employment. So full employment will pull in lots of people into the labor market who wouldn't be in there otherwise, but it will also leave people behind. Moreover, the level of skills that you need for even the kinds of direct employment jobs that I'm thinking of, whether it's through infrastructure or through more of the sort of things we did in the Recovery Act, requires more skills than some of the folks on the supply side have. So that's a critical piece of the puzzle as well. I think in terms of the incarceration piece, I've written about that pretty extensively and have been, you know, I've never been able to disprove this number that NELP comes up with. It says something like 70 million people have some sort of a criminal record. And if that's true, and I believe it is, then obviously there needs to be a strategy there. Now, we've touted Ban the Box, which I think is a good idea, and recently the White House had an executive order on that. I think those are great, but I think they're small potatoes compared to what we probably need to do to get to the folks that were implicit in your very well teed up question.
Yeah.
Hi. Tulsa is an interesting example. Some of us have been at gatherings with David Erickson from the San Francisco Federal Reserve, and he occasionally talks about all you need to move the needle is to have an enlightened billionaire and a super genius. And for those who are familiar with George Kaiser and the head of the CAP local community action program, you have that there. But my question is to you, Pedro, to talk a little bit about something you mentioned about what we know from integration in the 70s. Because, you know, Jared, I actually think what's interesting is, despite David Axelrod's anybody can sell good news, I actually think one of the challenges we face is that sort of one major political party kind of comes together and, you know, potentially elects a candidate who does things like the Recovery Act, and another party sort of sells a macroeconomic narrative that suggests that there's really no connection between going from 700,000 jobs to 271,000. So I want to ask about the good news story that I didn't know about, even though I went to an integrated school in the 70s, which is, you know, Pedro, so what do we know about what those investments paid off then, and what does it tell us now, coupled with what Raj was saying, that there doesn't seem to be an integration penalty for wealthier people?
Well, what we know is that the disparities were all closing up until the early 80s. And it, you know, there, again, I don't want to overemphasize the importance of school integration. I think that was a factor, but it wasn't the only factor. It was these other initiatives in housing and in employment. And I think, but that's a reminder, you know, Sean Reardon, who's come up already, points the same thing out. That is, if we could grow these disparities so quickly, we could also, through the other strategies, reduce them. And that's what we should keep in mind. There was a time, not that long ago, when they weren't as pronounced as they are now. And it takes a different kind of vision. And even at the local level, I don't see it very often. Right. I mean, despite what we heard about the progressive policies being adopted in San Francisco, I think they're piecemeal and they're not really addressing what it's going to take to keep that city livable for working class people. And, you know, I don't see that in New York. I don't see that in a number of places. That's why Tulsa stands out. But I think you're right. They have a unique opportunity there with the billionaire willing to invest in preschool. But I do think we got quite a few billionaires around here. And
can I just add to that? Look, we can't possibly build what I consider a reconnection agenda, and I know you're not suggesting that. We can't possibly build the reconnection equalizing upward mobility agenda on the backs of willing billionaires. Mm-hmm. And that's why we have a tax code.
Exactly. Here, here.
Okay, we have 2 minutes left, so if each of you could share your comment or your question, and then we'll wrap up.
All right, great. Thank you, Yusef, for the shout-out about housing as a vaccine. I can't not come up and give you kind of two more ideas in terms of the medical analogy. One is that dose matters, right? We don't do one round of chemotherapy and expect a cancer to be treated. We give it a full regimented dose. And so I think that part of the reason why we lack the place-based, evidence-based, is we have not tested it at the dose to which it should have been tested, right? I think the other question is that in medicine, more and more, we are recognizing that patient engagement makes our medicines more effective. And so that community engagement hasn't come up enough, right? Dudley Street Neighborhood Initiative is a great example of where it started with community engagement, and then they decided on the don't, you know, dump on us toxics. And it's been something that's been renewed. And our hospital, Boston Medical Center, with Renee Boynton-Jarrett, who's another pediatrician, leads the Vital Village Network, to again focus on 0 to 5 in that neighborhood with community engagement. And I wish we would talk about that as a essential component, that it starts with people first, because that will make the dose work and the patients healthier.
That's a very important point. Because here's another New Orleans issue. What was the first poor neighborhood in New Orleans to rebuild without any assistance? It was Versailles, the Vietnamese neighborhood, right? And guess what? They did it themselves to a large degree so successfully that they elected a Vietnamese Republican to Congress. Now, he only lasted 2 years. In fact, he was the only Republican to vote for the Affordable Care Act. That's why he only lasted 2 years, but
there was some money in the freezer that kind of facilitated that as well.
But the same thing in Detroit. You know, Detroit is, you know, there's a Mexican community in Detroit that's still vibrant, where money circulates. So to the point that was just made, that we got to think about how do we engage the people in the process of revitalizing their communities and not just see them as clients to be served, I think is an excellent point.
And that's my cue to end it. Thankfully, our last questioner disappeared. But thank you so much to my panel. Please join me in thanking them, and thank you guys.